Hi, this is Mr. Mack. This video deals with the binomial theorem. Now, a lot of this is attributed to a mathematician by the name of Blaise Pascal. And as we go through this, we'll get to something that you probably will recognize as something you've seen before. But I imagine one afternoon, Blaise Pascal was sitting at his breakfast table with nothing to do and binomials on his mind. And he said, "Let me just take a look at what I get when I expand the binomial a plus b to different powers." Of course, anything to the zero power is one. So a plus b to the 0 is 1, and a plus b to the 1 is 1a plus 1b. Now, a plus b squared, by now you do know this pattern, I'm sure, is 1a squared plus 2ab plus 1b squared. A plus b cubed, we have actually done that a couple of times, turns out to be 1a cubed plus 3a squared b plus 3ab squared plus 1b cubed. That was so much fun. Let's do it again. A plus b to the fourth is what you get when you multiply a plus b, or use a plus b as a factor four times, and you get 1a to the fourth plus 4a cubed b plus 6a squared b squared plus 4ab cubed plus 1b to the fourth. Let's do one more, and then we're going to stop and take a look at some patterns here. A plus b to the fifth he found to be 1a to the fifth plus 5a to the fourth b plus 10a cubed b squared plus 10a squared b cubed plus 5ab to the fourth plus 1b to the fifth. Now, it seems pretty obvious, I think, at this particular point that this pattern would continue, but let's go back and take a look at a few of the things that we see occurring in this pattern. First of all, we're going to see that let's get some kind of a highlighter here. Here we go. We're going to see that down this edge, we have all ones, and down this edge, we have all ones as our coefficients. Gosh, that straightened it out. Why did it do that? Anyway, we have all ones there, and we have all ones as our coefficient down the right-hand side. Now, also, notice that, let's just go ahead and get rid of those, because they're kind of in our way. We also have, as we go through the variables here, notice that the leading term in each case, A, has the same exponent as the exponent on the binomial, and the trailing term, if you will, the term that contains just b, also has the exponent of the binomial on it. Now, if we look at the exponents, on the terms in the middle, let me just point maybe to this term right here. Notice I've got a 2 on the A and a 1 on the B. And if you add 2 and 1 together, you get 3, which I don't want to move that. I want to move this. There we go, which is the exponent on the binomial. And, in fact, if you look at this pattern, every term, the coefficient, the exponent on A and the exponent on B in that term add to be the exponent on the binomial. Further, if you look at this, the exponents on the variables of A decrease 4, and then 3, and then 2, and then 1, and actually 0 here, because A to the 0 is 1, while the exponents on the B increase. They go from 0 here to 1 to 2 to 3 to 4. So as the first term exponents are decreasing from the exponent on the binomial to 0, the terms on the second term in the exponents on the second term in the binomial are increasing from 0 to 4 at the same time. Now, since we start with, let's just take a look at this one again. Since we start with b to the 0 and we end up with b to the 4th, if you were to count 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, you've actually said 5 things. So we have 5 terms. So the number of terms we get in an expansion is one more than the exponent on the binomial that we're expanding. Now, the next thing we'd like to look at is the actual coefficients themselves. And this is something that you've probably seen before. If we get rid of the terms, we just have 1, and then 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 3, 3, 1, 1, 4, 6, 4, 1, 1, 5, 10, 10, 5, 1. And this is known as Pascal's triangle. Now, some of the strange things that occur with Pascal's triangle is that it's possible to get the lines of this triangle, because if you look at this pattern, you'll see that any number, like this 10, for example, is actually the sum of the two numbers that are diagonally above it. So if we wanted to get the next row here, we would have a 1 on the outside, and then 1 plus 5 would be 6, 5 plus 10 would be 15, 10 plus 10 would be 20, 10 plus 5 would be 15, 5 plus 1 would be 6, and then we'd have 1 on the outside here. Now, what we can do then, we can use this information to actually expand a plus b to the 6th power. See, if we wanted to know a plus b to the 6th power, we know it's going to start with a coefficient of 1, and we're going to have a to the 6th. Then we're going to have a coefficient of 6, and we're going to have a to 1 power less, 5, and b to the 1, that's 1 more than b to the 0, plus 15. I'll pause a second. You say what it's going to be? Yes, a to the 4th b squared, and then plus 20. Pause again. A cubed b cubed plus 15 a squared b to the 4th plus 6 a b to the 5th plus 1 b to the 6th. All right. Now, if you understand what we've been doing, then what I'm going to say now is I would like you to pause the video and write down in your notes the expansion for a plus b to the 7th. It's now time to pause. Hi, welcome back. What you should have written was 1 a to the 7th plus 7 a to the 6th b plus 21 a to the 5th b squared plus 35 a to the 4th b cubed plus 35 a to the 3rd b to the 4th plus 21 a squared b to the 5th plus 7 a b to the 6th plus 1 b to the 7th. And you can see, at least I hope you can see, that what you can do then is you can use Pascal's triangle in this pattern to write down what you would get if you expanded the binomial a plus b to any power. Now, I'll admit, if we do something a little crazy like ask for a plus b to the 100th power, that would take quite a lot. So perhaps you'd have to be motivated. Maybe algebra would kidnap you and say, give us a plus b to the 100th and we'll let you go. But you do know how to do it, at least. Okay, so now the coefficients, or the triangular coefficients, are called um, uh, are called the Pascal's triangle. Now, they're also called the binomial coefficients, and it turns out that these binomial coefficients, I'm going to take these two terms here, group them, and minimize them so that we can have a little more room to work on things here. It turns out that these binomial coefficients can also be computed using what using a study of mathematics called combinatorics. Now let me move this little Martian out of the way here. There we go. So if we wanted, for example, we need to identify a couple of things. We will call this first row here row 0, and this would be row 1, and this row would be row 2 of Pascal's triangle. And so this row right here would be row 6. Now, this would be the first element in row 6. This would be the second element in row 6. This would be the third element in row 6, and so forth like that. Now, if we wanted, for example, to find the third element in row 6, what we could do is we could say that's going to be equal to 6 factorial over 2 factorial 6 minus 2 factorial. Now, 6 factorial is 6 times 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. 2 factorial is 2 times 1. And 6 minus 2 is 4. And 4 factorial is 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. Now notice we can cancel out the 1s. We can cancel out the 2s, the 3s, the 4s. And 2 will cancel with the 6, leaving 3. And 3 times 5 is 15. And you'll notice that the number I'm pointing at is 15. Now, the question that probably popped into your mind, you say, well, this is the third term, but Mr. McFarland, how come then did we use 2? Well, we always use 1 less than the number of the term, because really in this case, we start counting with 0. Remember, this term was the one that had b to the 0, and then the term with the 6 in front of it had the b to the 1. So this number right here turns out to be the exponent on, I'm going to say b, but remember now, we're thinking of b as the second term in the binomial. Now, the question probably pops up at this particular, also, we need to do a little bit of notation here. Now, the book likes to use this notation, NCR. Now, notice there's a big C with a little subscript of N to the left of it and a little subscript of R to the right of it. Now, we define this number. A lot of times, these are called the binomial coefficients. You may have had a gifted class in the past that called these the choose numbers because they have other characteristics which are really pretty cool. But we define the binomial coefficients, or NCR, to be n factorial over r factorial n minus r factorial. Okay. Now, one of the good news, one of the good things about this is this function is actually built into your calculator. Now, you do need to know this because on the actual end of course exam, they're not going to let you use your calculator, but if you are doing something for class, you can use the calculator. And let's just take a look at that. Let's say we wanted to go ahead and find this one. 6 choose 2. Now, the way you do that is you first press the 6 and then press the button that says math and go across the top to PRB, and notice the third function down is NCR, so press 3. Notice now we've got 6 and CR, and we're going to give it 2. And we're hoping that the calculator will tell us 15, and it does. So you can use the calculator to find these binomial coefficients in that fashion. Now, the question is, what good is this? Well, there are a couple of things that are good about this. Let's just start with one application that they do mention in our book. Let's say it's equally likely that you're going to hire a male or a female for a particular job. You're in human you work in human resources in a large corporation, and you have a large number of applicants, and about half of them are male, about half of them are female, and they're all qualified. So the probability that you will choose a male or a female is relatively equal. Okay, and you've got 8 jobs available now, so you're going to hire 8 people. And the question is, what is the probability that you will hire, oh, let's say 6 females, and 2 males? Well, if we let X be the number of males and Y be the number of females we hire, then if you expand the binomial X plus Y to the 8th, a strange thing happens. Watch this. This is 1X to the 8 plus 8X to the 7Y plus 28X to the 6Y squared plus, let's see, 56X to the 5Y cubed plus, I probably should have done Pascal's triangle before I did this. I'm trying to do this on the fly. Seventy X to the 4th, Y to the 4th. I said 70, wrote 7. I can handle this. There we go. 70 X to the 4th, Y to the 4th, plus. Now, you've probably noticed this already. Once you reach the middle, it's going to go back down with the same number. So we have 56 X to the 3rd, Y to the 5th, plus 28 X to the 2nd, Y to the 6th, plus 8 XY to the 7th, plus 1 Y to the 8th. Now, the coefficients of each of these terms are the number of different ways, if you're choosing 8 people, that you can select. The first one, for example, the number of ways you can select all X's out of a group of X's and Y's would be 1 if you're selecting 8. Now, if the number of ways you can select 8 X's and 1 Y it's 7 X's and 1 Y is 8. The number of ways you can select 6 X's and 2 Y's is 28, and so on like that. Now, if you add all of these coefficients up, the strange thing about this is you get 256. That's the sum of all of the coefficients, 1 plus 8 plus 28 plus 56 plus 70, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so we're asking, what's the probability that we'll hire 6 females and 2 males? So we're going to look at the term that has an exponent of 6 on the Y and an exponent of 2 on the X, and that's 28. So the probability is 8 over 256. Now, I'm sure you realize there's a factor of 4 in 28, and there's a factor of 4 in 256. So the probability that if you just randomly hire males and females for these 8 jobs, the probability that 6 females and 2 males will be hired is 7 over 24. Now, that is called a binomial experiment, and this is finding a binomial probability. One other thing that I would like to mention is that you can use these patterns to expand binomials that don't have just, like, say, an X and a Y for the two terms, or an A and a B. So let's take a look at that. Let's imagine that we would like to expand 3X minus 2Y to the 5th power. Now, what we're going to do, let me move this down just a little bit here. What we're going to do first is we're going to do a plus b to the fifth. Now, I think we have it up there already. It's 1a to the fifth plus 5a to the fourth b plus 10a cubed b squared plus 10a squared b cubed plus 5ab to the fourth plus 1b to the fifth. Now, what we're going to do with our binomial is we're going to make this, that's a supposed to be a negative 2 there. Okay, so we have 3x plus negative 2y. Now, in this case, 3x is going to be a, and negative 2y is going to be b. And so what we can do is we can substitute in 3x wherever we see a, and negative 2y wherever we see b. Now, let me warn you to be careful. When you substitute 3x for a and negative 2y for b, 3x and negative 2y have to be inside parentheses with the exponent outside, at least to start with, and then you're going to need to simplify. So let's see what we get. We get 1, a, 3x, 3x, I can do this. There we go. 3x to the fifth plus 5 times a, that's 3x, to the fourth, b, that's negative 2y, plus 10 a, that's 3x cubed, b, that's negative 2y squared, plus 10 a, that's 3x squared, b, that's negative 2y cubed, plus 5 a, that's 3x times b, that's negative 2y to the fourth, plus 1 b, that's negative 2y to the fifth. Now, guys, I will not give you credit if you stop at this particular point, because this information is almost completely unusable. You need to go through and clean up the mess and do your algebra. I require that of you, and that shouldn't be too bad. Now, see, 3x to the fifth means that we're raising 3x to the fifth power. In other words, 3x times 3x times 3x. So what we've got is 3 to the fifth. You and I both know that's 243. X to the fifth, right? Plus, now, we're going to deal with the coefficient here first. 5 times 3 to the fourth. 3 to the fourth is 81. 81 times 5 is 405. And then we're multiplying that by negative 2, so we get negative 810. So the second term's coefficient is going to be negative 810. And then we have x to the fourth, y. Then the next term, we have 10 times 3 cubed. 3 cubed is 27. 27 times 10 is 270. 270 times, now, negative 2 squared is positive 4. So 270 times positive 4 is going to give us 1080. And then the variables will be x cubed, y squared. Now, the next term is going to be 10 times 3 squared. 3 squared is 9. 9 times 10 is 90. Times negative 2 cubed. Negative 2 cubed is negative 8. 90 times negative 8 is negative 720. And then we have x squared, y cubed. Now, the next term, we have 5 times 3, that's 15, times negative 2 to the fourth. Negative 2 to the fourth is 16. And 16 times 15 is 240, x, y to the fourth. And then finally, we have negative 2y to the fifth. That's negative 2 to the fifth, which is negative 32, y to the fifth. Okay, and this would be the expansion of 3x minus 2y to the fifth. I will expect you to be able to do that on the test, so study that and practice that. All right, now, finally, the last thing I need to do is I need to state this binomial theorem actually in sigma notation and so forth, and then we need to talk about picking out a particular term, because that's kind of an important thing also. Okay, so the binomial theorem basically says for natural number, for whole numbers, n, a plus b to the n is going to be n c 0 a to the n b to the 0 plus n c 1 a to the n minus 1 b to the 1 plus n c 2 a to the n minus 2 b to the 2 plus dot 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 plus n c n a to the 0, that's n minus n, b to the n. Now, this can be stated in sigma notation as, so in other words, a plus b to the n in sigma notation is sigma k equals 0 to n of n c k a to the n minus k b to the k. Now, and remember, nck is defined to be n factorial over k factorial, n minus k factorial. Now, the question is, if we were to say to you, give us the seventh term of this, or the ninth term of that, how would you do that? Well, first of all, you've got to realize, if you look at this, the exponent on b, the second term in the binomial, is one less than the number of the term. See, b starts with b to the 0, and then b to the 1, and then b squared, and so forth. But this b to the 0 actually is the first term, and b to the 1 is the second term. So if we say, give the, let's give an example here, give the fourth term in the expansion of 2x plus y to the 7th. Now, in this case, a is going to be 2x, and b is going to be y. And if we want the fourth term, then it's going to be 7c3. This is very important that you understand where I got this 3. Remember, this number right here is the exponent on b in the term. And remember, to get to 4, if we're to the fourth term, if we start with 0, take your hands, put out four fingers, and touch the first one and say 0, touch the second and say 1, touch the third one and say 2, touch the fourth one and say 3. So 3 is going to be the number here. Now, that gives us then 2x to the 7 minus 3 times y to the 3. Now, 7c3, let's just back this up by using the calculator and finding out what 7c3 is. We turn the calculator on, we type the 7, then you press math, go over to probability and choose NCR, and then choose a 3 and press enter. I think it's 56. No, it's 35. So we have 35. Now, 2 to the 4th is 16, x to the 4th, y cubed. Now, we do need to multiply 35 by 16, and we get 560. So the answer is 560, x to the 4th, y to the 3rd. And that's how you find the fourth term. Now, if they tell you instead, give us the term that has x to the fifth, you would know that x to the fifth would mean that y would have to be to the second, and so you would be using a 2 in that second spot where we have the 3 at the moment. So, this should take care of the concepts for the binomial theorem, and this is an important study, so please take care to really think about these problems as you do them. And we're done.